Joyful, joyful, beautiful. morning's first reading is from the book of Romans, chapter 7, verses 15 to 25. I do not understand my own actions, for I do not do what I want, but I do the very thing I hate. Now, if I do what I do not want, I agree that the law is good. But in fact, it is no longer I that do it, but sin that dwells within me. For I know that nothing good dwells within me, that is, in my flesh. I can will what is right, but I cannot do it. For I do not do the good I want, but the evil I do not want is what I do. Now, if I do what I do not want, it is no longer I that do it, but sin that dwells within me. So I find it to be a law that when I want to do what is good, evil lies close at hand. For I delight in the law of God in my inmost self, but I see in my members another law at war with the law of my mind, making me captive to the law of sin that dwells in my members. Wretched man that I am, who will rescue me from this body of death? Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then, with my mind, I am a slave to the law of God, but with my flesh, I am a slave to the law of sin.
Nice message. Would any of our kids like to come up, or? I'm going to share just a quick message, and the message, let's see if I can get this up. Oh, hello there. So, the guy gave me this. You know what this is, right? It's a brick. And the reason he gave me the brick is because it has P-R-A-Y, and I guess it was Pray Corporation that made bricks, and so he gave me this Pray brick, and maybe it weighs 5 pounds. I'm gonna hold that. I won't let it go. But see how heavy that is? Okay, that's kind of heavy, and you know, it's heavy, but I think I can hold for a while. I don't think I can hold it out for too long. My arm would get tired. My muscles aren't big enough. Pretty soon, that Pray brick would start to get too much of a burden. It would keep falling down. I wouldn't be able to keep it up here. And we're going to hear a gospel today. Jesus says, come to me all who are weary and who are heavy burdened, and I will give you rest. And so what he's saying is that when your burdens get to be too much, you can maybe hold on to them for a while, but eventually you just don't have enough strength to get it up there. And then Jesus, he says, you come to me and I'll help you. Now I got a picture I want to show you. Let's see if you can make this out, because sometimes it's not easy to see. Can you see? Can you figure out what that picture is? Yeah, that's a hand statue. You know what that is? A tree. So here, you know, off the picture is the trunk of the tree. And then there's this really, really big, heavy limb growing sideways for some reason. And then it starts to grow up straight again. And so the town said, this branch isn't going to survive. It's going to break off of the trunk because this is too heavy. So they built a little statue. The statue's got a base. It's got a hand. And the hand is holding up the limb of the tree because the tree can't do it on its own. So the hand is there to help hold up that branch of the tree so it doesn't break and die. And so that's the same message that Jesus says. Sometimes we got things in our lives, even really young lives, that are just like too much to hold out there on our own. And when they get to be too much, Jesus says, you come to me, and I'll help you hold that up. Okay? So that's why we come to church, that's why we say our prayers, all that kind of stuff, because when Jesus says it gets a little bit too heavy, we can't hold it up anymore, I'm there for you. Okay? So you count on Jesus like that, okay? All right. You enjoy the rest of the church. I'm going to put my pray brick away. There we go. And our special shepherd lead us. Time for us to share in our joys and our celebrations and our concerns, and let us offer prayers for the nation of Ukraine. I think I saw on the news today that today is the 500th day of that war since Russia crossed the border into Ukraine. So let us pray for all those people who are suffering, and that somehow these two nations and the world will find a way to peace there. We also continue to pray for our nation as we face the reality of persistent and racism, and also prayers for all in the world who are suffering through this historic heat and climate change. I don't know how scientists do it, maybe through tree rings, or I don't know exactly how, but they said this past week was the hottest in 125,000 years, and worldwide, the records that they actually do have, president. And so we pray for Reverend Karen Georgia Thompson and also for her successful ministry. Because even though she's at the top of UCC, what she does filters down right here to Sunderland Congregational Church. So prayers for Reverend Karen Georgia Thompson. Are there any joys, celebrations, concerns that anybody would like to offer from here in the church? Or even at home? Yes, Pat?
I'd just like a prayer for the Waskevich family in Hadley. You know, the barn that, and the house that burned. Well, the daughter is a friend of mine, and I don't know whether you saw it in the paper or not, but her father passed away. Heartbroken, apparently.
The man who lived in that house?
Yeah.
He passed away. Oh,
I didn't realize that, but I saw her last week, and she said, yeah, we figure he was heartbroken. And so just prayers for that family, because two tragedies in a row, they need all the prayers they can get. So.
Yeah, absolutely. Any other joy, celebrations, concerns? Anybody home? What's up? Okay, then let's turn to our yellow sheet and offer the prayers for those listening. So prayers for Alan, Alice, Pam, Antonia, my family, Art, Barbara, Bill, Bonnie, Carrie, Cheryl, Cindy, Denise, Evelyn, Frank, Grayson, Hayden, Jeff, John, Kathy, Kevin, Lauren, Marcia, Martha, Mary Jane, Michelle, Mike, Paula, Pauline, Prue, Bart, Sabrina, Sandra, Cheryl, Steve, Thelma, Virginia and Richard, Wayne, victims of violence anywhere in the world, those affected by natural disasters around the globe, and we pray for peace on earth. Now may we turn inward for just a few moments of silence to offer God those prayers and petitions that the chief just had to say out loud. So just a few moments of silence. Holy God, in whose presence we find joyous delight, may we learn from Jesus to share with one another our burdens, and so also we can pick up their burdens when we are able, to extend to those with heavy burdens our help and comfort in time of distress, and also expect and welcome the same in return when we need them. We also ask that we might be united across time and space in the community of this mutual caring, where you reign powerfully among us when we live as you once lived, caring for everyone. We also ask that you hear the prayers that we have shared with you, and that they also may be answered as you alone know best. These things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. And may we now share the prayer that Jesus gave to all of us, the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. uplift and his worship. The ability to check our lives, all the burdens, and get them over to Jesus, and that allows us to continue in ways that we would not be able to otherwise. And also through our generosity, through the schools and everything else, we also reach out beyond these walls to uplift those who are in desperate need for our gifts. So for all of you who continue to support this church, God bless you, and may God bless these gifts so that they continue to be Jesus' presence. And today's reflecting hymn is from the blue hymnal number 68, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing.
Treasures, you know, it just doesn't translate into a monetary
connection there, so that even if they're offered a ton of money, they still hold on to what they have. So whether it's a previously unrecognized Rembrandt that actually happened to one lucky family, or a piece of great-grandmother's now recognized costume and jewelry that really isn't worth a lot, the sentimental value is more often than not outweighed anything that somebody would offer to take that away from them. So the connection that that item, whether it's a Rembrandt or a piece of costume jewelry, it connects you to a memory, to a person, and no matter how much money somebody offers, only 1% accept the offer. 99% keep the memory. And here's a somewhat similar story. Will Dowd wrote about his father's retirement, and his father was a federal investigator. And his kids bought him a kayak, thinking, oh, he's going to enjoy his retirement. He's going to go out on the lake. He's going to fish in his kayak. And he's going to enjoy himself. Instead, the father went into his basement, and he set up an office down there. And the father, he went back in time through, you know, all these skills he has as a federal investigator, and he traced his family tree. The Irish family sent ancestors everywhere in the world. And all those connections, they got broken. But this federal investigator would have remarkable progress in tracking down people. And with each additional ancestor, someone who was dead, the living relatives grew that much larger. So Will Dowd writes in the Boston Globe magazine, as it turns out, my father was never chasing the dead, he was chasing the living. His research will prove that everyone gathered in the function hall for our family reunion were all linked by blood. We may be strangers to each other. Remember, there were broken connections. People have gone in every which direction. They don't even know what each other looks like. So we may be strangers to each other, but his research will show beyond a shadow of a doubt that we are family, his family. So whether through some handed-down heirloom that may or most likely may not be worth very much, or through some newly discovered distant cousin, people appreciate the bonds that hold them together. And when we discover those connections that we never realized were there, those connections that hold us together, that revelation of connection can be so exciting that it actually just goes right over all the differences that we tend to emphasize that separate us. When they can see for the first time the connections that they are really united more than they're not, all of a sudden, people come together in ways that you would never expect without someone pointing out the connection. And that is not extraordinary. You know, that's the very definition of ordinary. Remember from that Antiques Roadshow, only 1% of the people for 28 seasons gave up with either treasure or their, what they thought was treasure, and sold it. 99% kept all of those mementos because those mementos meant something more than the money they could get. 99% is basically everyone. So the ordinary is that connection is really significant to all of us. And what Jesus tries to tease out in his life, his ministry, and also his message is this ordinary response that we discover when we have connections with other people. But Jesus makes it extraordinary because he doesn't just see those connections in obvious ways. You know, my cousin or my neighbor or, you know, somebody I work with. Jesus sees those connections in everybody, everywhere. No matter what we look like, no matter how much money we have or don't have, where we come from, Jesus sees those connections that we don't. And kind of like that retired federal investigator, you know, who revealed family connections that had been broken and disappeared long generations ago, Jesus expands that revelation to everyone so that we see the connections that really, in Jesus' eyes, bring the whole world together. Remember little Rosa Parks, the black woman who wouldn't give up her seat to some white guy wanting to sit down? So Rosa Parks, you know, who's this icon of this racial justice movement, she doesn't talk about black or white. She once says, I believe there's only one race, the human race. I think when Jesus heard Rosa Parks say that, he shook his head in agreement. And this is the reality that inspires Jesus in today's gospel to say, come to me, all of you who are weary and carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. He doesn't say, you know, only you people up in Nazareth. He doesn't say only you Jewish people and not you Gentiles. Jesus says, all of you come to me, who are heavy burden, and I will give you rest. So for Jesus, this is important. Everyone matters. Come to me, all of you who are weary. You know, that's an irreplaceable gift, because sometimes in life, when we just don't have the hope in ourselves to be able to continue, we have faith, and all of a sudden, there's that gift that we can continue, that Jesus gives us hope, that Jesus, like that picture I'm showing, is that statuate arm holding up that heavy limb that would break otherwise. Jesus is there when we can't do it on our own, and that is an irreplaceable gift. And this is one of the most important pastoral messages I think there is. And that's why, you know, to visit the sick and the homebound, the hospitalized and the dying is so important, because when people are at their weakest, when they don't have hope, Jesus says, come to me, all who are weary and heavy burdened, like that statue, I will help you, I will carry that with you, I will give you rest. That message has to be shared. And that's one of the reasons that coming to church and building a faith is such a blessing. But Jesus doesn't stop with what Jesus does for us. Jesus is always going to ask us to follow in his footsteps. So he follows up with how he's connecting with all of us. And his second message is, take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart. Now English, like other languages, you know, other languages allow you to have a singular you and a plural you. In English, it's just you. Whether I'm talking about you or all of you, it's just you. But in the Greek that the Bible is written in, there is a single you and a plural you. And when it says, take my yoke upon you, that means not just like me or you, it means all of us, you plural. So take my yoke upon you in the plural. And with this in mind, while the imagery of the yoke is not famous anymore, like I don't think I've ever seen a yoke. You know, the idea of a yoked oxen, which you take two of these big, burly beasts, you yoke them together, and as the hand of the driver, you can lead these oxen where they need to go in the field or down the road or whatever. But that's what a yoke does. And a yoke is not singular. A yoke is plural. So Jesus' imagery, the yoke upon you, is that we work together led by Jesus' hand. Learn from me, he said, is the call to imitate Jesus when he says, come to me, all who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. So like that federal investigator, reveal unseen connections, so does Jesus. And when all of us see like Jesus sees, when we put on that yoke, all of us sharing that same burden, then all of a sudden the yoke becomes easy and the burden light, because it's shared amongst all of us. Things that we can't do on our own, we can do together. And what a glorious world this would be if we would only see as Jesus sees. And not only because of what Jesus does, but because of what Jesus inspires us to do. So adapting Will Down's words about his father's work in the family tree, we may be strangers to each other. We may not know all the people that we're going to help or be able to help, but Jesus shows us beyond a shadow of a doubt that we are all family. We're all his family. So may this insight inspire us to hope in Jesus when hope in our lives is hard to come by, and also to care for one another when they have nothing to hope in. Maybe we can be Jesus' presence in their lives and for them. And for these things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. And our hymn of closing today is from the blue hymnal number 504, Just a Closer Walk with Thee. Thank you. Suffering and who are discouraged. And in the spirit, let us now go forth to love.